I want to preach from the subject. Have you been to the water?
All right.
Have you been to the water? I find it interesting that on this particular morning, that as I prepare to preach the subject, have you been to the water, we are surrounded today by a lot of water.
Right.
Just falling from heaven's sky.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And you know, it just amazed me how ironic that is to me when I had no idea it would be raining like this morning, but it's so ironic that we are here today talking about going to the water.
Yeah.
Some people might think going to the water is pulling out the boat or the yacht and taking it out on the lake with some friends and partying and drinking and fishing and having a good time. But that's not the water I'm talking about today. Because when Philip was called by the Lord to overtake a chariot headed to Gaza, that was more to overcome than just the chariot. Philip would come across a man, and this man was reading God's word, but he didn't understand it. And don't that sound like some of us sometimes?
Yeah.
We read God's word, and we know the words that we are pronouncing, but it just don't make sense. This man needed guidance. This man needed encouragement from someone who had an understanding of the word of God. This man needed knowledge, and this man needed a change of heart so that he might understand the word of God.
Yes.
As they came upon some water, this man asked the question. This man asked the question, see, here's water. What hinders me from being baptized? With this question, we can draw a conclusion from the passage that it was believed that baptism was necessary for salvation. If not the case, there would be no reason for any of us, especially this Ethiopian, to make this request. But in an even more practical sense, we should also see that some things might hinder people from obeying the gospel of Jesus Christ.
That's it.
Yes.
And because of this, there are so many questions about the gospel, and in particular, and especially for today, there's a question about baptism. So some might want to know, and some might ask, what is baptism? Baptism is simply an outward expression of an inward change.
All right.
The old people used to say something got a hold of me and it wouldn't let go.
Yeah.
Ever since I met Jesus, my life hadn't been the same. Because every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. And as we think about what this change can do, baptism is a public declaration of how Jesus changed your life. Being baptized, it shows others that you have decided to follow Jesus. And it allows all to celebrate this decision with you. I'm reminded of seeing kids in college and probably reflecting on some of my college days when women and men join sororities and fraternities. And they have what's called a pledging process that takes some time, anywhere from 4 to 6 to 8 to 12 weeks of initiation into a particular sorority or fraternity. And in doing so, at the end of what's called the final week, which is called Hell Week, is the day that they call crossing the burning sands. in doing so, they had this phrase called going over, coming offline. And when they do that, they receive all type of gifts, be it jackets, t-shirts, sweaters, plaques, and all type of different type of paraphernalia to let everybody know that they are a member of whatever particular sorority or fraternity they just pledged their allegiance to. And some love it so much so that they get tattoos on their bodies. They get brands on their body. I'm talking heated brands. They get tags for their cars. They get all these type of things to let everybody know that they belong to this particular sorority or fraternity.
Mm-hmm.
And it would just be so nice if people were that excited about being baptized into Christianity.
Yes.
Why we don't have a cross brand on our arms and on our chest? Why we don't get tattoos of Jesus on our body? Why we don't get as excited about people who wear the colors of their sororities and fraternities? Why we don't act as excited about what Jesus did for us as opposed to what a sorority or fraternity has done for the person who pledged or joined it? But let me tell you about what baptism does not do for people. Being baptized won't save you, because baptism is the symbol and the celebration of your salvation. It wasn't the water that saved you. The water was the symbol. And when you think about it, Peter, in the first book of Peter, the 3rd chapter and the 21st verse, it explains it. It talks about the power that brought Jesus back to life is the same power that Jesus uses to change our life.
Yes.
And that's worth getting excited about.
That's it.
And when we realize that that power changed our life, the baptism is the coming out party to let everybody know that we belong to Team Jesus. Jesus Phi Jesus. Jesus Cap. Jesus Epsilon Jesus, or whatever other names you want to use to make it make sense to you.
Mm-hmm.
So, my next question is, why should I be baptized?
Mm-hmm.
So now that we know what it is, why should I be baptized? Why does it matter that I get baptized? Uh-huh. The Bible tells us that Jesus instructed us to be baptized.
Mm-hmm.
And not only did he instruct us, he showed us that he did it himself. He set the example, and the stories tells us this in Matthew 28, 19 and 20, and Mark, the 1st chapter and the 9th verse. Because as Christians, as people who belong to the body of Christ, our obedience to Jesus shows we believe and we follow his instructions.
Mm-hmm.
And when you've gotten baptized, there are witnesses to be able to give an account that, yes, you have shown your commitment to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ by going through the process of being baptized. Because Jesus went public about his love for us, we should be able to go public about our love for him.
All right.
And that's what baptism is doing. Being baptized, it shows that we turn away from our sinful nature. It shows that we are turning away from sin and turning toward the love of Jesus.
That's it. That's it.
And Jesus is the only one who can change us and show us that kind of love.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
So, what is baptized? Why should I get baptized? When is the best time to be baptized?
Mm-hmm.
When you decide to follow Jesus.
That's it.
Yes.
How could you get baptized into the love of Jesus if you haven't decided to follow him.
Mm-hmm.
If you haven't decided to let him change your heart and change your way of thinking. Anyone who commits his or her life to following Jesus is ready to be baptized.
All right.
Anyone who is ready to commit their life, not just your money, not just your time, not just your interest, but your life to Jesus, then you are ready to be baptized. Some might want to know, well, what about children? Do we baptize children? As parents, we can help point our children in the direction of Jesus.
Uh-huh.
But ultimately, it's up to the child to decide if they're gonna follow Jesus.
Yeah.
As parents, we can lead them. We can show them the way by our words and how we live our life in obedience to Jesus. Unfortunately, a lot of parents rely on everything and everybody else to do that job for them.
Yeah.
And in doing so, that keeps our children from seeing and following Jesus because there's no one who they love or care about showing them the way.
That's it.
In an instance of baptisms, it follows a person's decision to trust Jesus for his or her salvation. I'm so glad that Champions for Christ, I believe that in waiting until children are old enough to make that decision with the encouragement of the adults that love them.
All right.
You know, there are some parents who force children to be baptized. There are some who bribe children to be baptized. Mm-hmm. But the best way to get our children baptized is to show them the example of the love of Jesus in such a way that they want it so much more than anything they could ever imagine.
Yeah.
What's the difference? You know, people want to talk about, well, do I get sprinkled? Do I get submerged or immersed? What's the difference in baptism?
Mm-hmm.
In the Bible, baptism was done by immersion, submersion. And that's what John the Baptist did to Jesus. And that's the one that most of us want to try to follow. Now, I understand in life, there might not be enough water to be submerged. So there's some who use the breaking of water, but not submerging. And who's to say who's right, who's wrong? Because again, baptism don't save us. Baptism is the symbol
of the
fact that we have been saved.
That's it.
So how much water is needed? Let me share it from this perspective. The original word for baptism most often referred to being immersed, submerged in water. And when Jesus was baptized, him being immersed and submerged, it meant something because the submersion in the water symbolized death. You went into the water, you got buried, and when you rose up out of the water, you were resurrected into Jesus. Hence the submersion, the immersion. And being raised out of the water is a picture of how Jesus raised us and gave us a fresh start in life.
Thank you, Lord.
So there are some who might want to know, well, since I didn't get immersed, since I didn't get submerged, or since I got sprinkled, or since I got tapped, do I need to get baptized again? I can't answer that for you because the Bible declares that I believe we are in one faith, one baptism, serving one Lord.
That's it.
But I understand the outward show, and there are sometimes you might have got baptized and there was no witnesses. Mm-hmm. And you want witnesses to see that you are living for Christ. So there are some who were baptized, those who've been baptized before, and there are some who won't. It's just the preference of particular faith practices. But being baptized is a symbol. It's the t-shirt that we wear. It's the brand on our arm. It's the tattoos we get on our body to let people know that we belong to Jesus, and it's just a sign. But what we need is more than a sign, because we need the action, the follows, to show people that we love Jesus and we are living our life for him.
That's it. That's it.
How many of you know that God never asks us to take a next step that isn't good for us?
Uh-huh.
What do I mean? There are some who believe I don't have to be baptized to be saved. I pretty much answered that. But what's wrong with taking the next step? Mm-hmm. What's wrong with coming out, not to mean negatively, what's wrong with coming out the closet of sinners? Why sinners not coming out the closet? Everybody else come out, why not sinners?
Mm-hmm.
Why not Christians who used to be sinners come out the closet?
Mm-hmm.
I believe that the Lord always give us more than we deserve, or giving us more than we can ever imagine. The Bible tells us that. Including the joy that we receive from listening to the Lord and doing what the Lord instructs us to do. Many people want to know, can someone go to heaven if they died before they got baptized? My belief, based off of my biblical understanding, I give two answers, the short answer and the long answer.
Mm-hmm.
The short answer is yes. The long answer is, it breaks my heart every time someone asks that question, especially, mm-hmm. especially upon the death of a loved one.
Yeah, yeah.
The untimely death of a loved one, it's so heartbreaking. Especially when we wasn't expecting it. Especially when there was no sickness, no disease. It breaks our heart when someone suddenly lose their life and we are left wondering.
Yeah.
Did that person get their life right?
Uh-huh.
Did I do everything I could to show and share the good news of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ with them? Did I even tell them about Jesus? Did I even mention Jesus to them? Did I even let them know that they had an option that they can choose Jesus for themselves?
Yeah, yeah.
Or did I just talk about sports? Did I just talk about my garden? Did I just talk about my pets, my children, my grandchildren? Did I just talk about work? Did I let them know that they too can have the same Jesus that I have?
All right.
It should break your heart when someone passed and you have to ask the question, did they love the Lord? Did they know the Lord? Had they accepted the Lord? And you being a friend, you being a family member, and you never said a word. You never even mentioned about Jesus. You never even invited them to church. You never even told them that you were baptized. You don't even remember your baptism date. You don't even show your baptism certificate. What is keeping us from going to the water? We have to ask the hard questions. We have to sometimes be unpopular to family and friends and loved ones. Every now and then, we have to do like the dentist and say, this is going to be a little discomfort. You're going to feel a little pinch. But after it's all over, everything's going to be all right. That's how we have to see presenting the gospel to some people sometime. Especially when we're trying to get them to live the life that will help them in eternity.
That's it.
While Jesus told Nicodemus Amen, amen, I say to you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of the water and the Spirit. Mm-hmm. And he did not set baptism as a hindrance to salvation, but just the opposite. It was a sign to let the world know that you belong to Jesus.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember growing up seeing a lot of signs as a kid, hearing about a lot of signs. And the sign that stood out to me the most was the horoscopes. Mm. People would tell you what zodiac sign they belong to. But how many people share their baptism sign? How many people let you know that they were baptized on a particular day? Mm-hmm. I love letting people know about June 17th, 1979. Because that was a day that I will always remember. I remember growing up and I would share the story about my Uncle Milton, how every Sunday when they would open up the doors to the church, he would nudge me. Go on down there, go on down there. And I wish I would have been old enough to remember him going down there. But since I didn't see him go down there, but I knew he had already been down there. But I wish I would have saw that, because that would have gave me a little more encouragement. But I would be ready to fight him. Yeah, because he's always trying to get me to go down and join the church. And yes, I was going to church with them every Sunday, but I didn't understand the love of Jesus at the time. But I knew what baptism meant. Yeah. I knew people going down and getting baptized. And I was afraid because for some reason, I didn't know what it meant. Mm-hmm. We have to realize the importance of instructing people and encouraging people about showing some sign. And for the Christian, it's the sign of baptism. Mm-hmm. If you don't remember the date, the time, and or the place, or the person who baptized you, ask the Lord to help you remember. Mm-hmm. Yes. Ask somebody who might have witnessed it. When was it? It could be an approximate until you find the exact. But you should start reflecting on the moment you gave the sign. And usually the sign will point you to the actual event of the change of heart that made you or led you to that sign.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm amazed, talking about zodiac signs for a brief moment, how there are so many people who will let you know their zodiac sign, tell you the characteristics of it, and live out those characteristics. Oh yeah, don't trust no Taurus. You know, they bullish. You know, they so stubborn, they got a hard head. And you know, we can tell you everything about people's zodiac signs, and they can tell you about their signs. But how many of us could tell you about the sign of being a Christian?
That's it.
Yeah.
We have to realize it's important that we take people to the water. And what I mean is showing them the love of Jesus so they want to come to it. So what hinders us? What keeps us from being baptized? First, a lack of connection. Mm-hmm. We are not connected to anyone who's living the life of a joyful Christian. We don't see anybody acting like they are loving, serving Jesus. So we don't have that connection to feel like we need to have Jesus for ourselves. Mm-hmm. So in order to keep people from using that as an excuse, we need to abide in the Word of God. Yes. We need to teach Jesus. We need to preach Jesus. We need to live for Jesus before our family and our friends. Mm-hmm. The next thing is there's a lack of conviction. Mm-hmm. People don't feel like they need it. Why do I need to be baptized? You baptized, look at you. You ain't different. You just like me. Why should I get baptized just to act like you? Mm-hmm. You mean as a snake. Why do I need to be baptized to be like you? You still go out and do all type of evil. Why should I be baptized? There's nothing convicting people to be baptized.
Yeah.
Faith is not just believing in something. It's fully trusting and relying upon it. And in the life of a Christian, it's the Lord.
All right.
Another reason people are not going to the water to be baptized, there's a lack of correction. We just let people get away with any and everything. And, you know, we have gotten so passive and so soft as Christians. We just let people get away with anything.
Yeah, yeah.
Even telling you that you're wrong as a Christian. What happened to defending who you are in Christ?
That's it. That's it.
Yeah.
What happened to standing on the word of God to define what you're trying to live your life as? You know, people always talk about, you know, I don't talk about religion and politics. Why not? You talk about everything else. And you don't know enough about that either. So we have to understand and we have to start correcting ourselves and correcting others in love.
That's it.
And let me share this. You can't correct nobody fully if they don't know that you love them. And that's what we mess up at a lot. We try to correct other people's kids that we don't even know. Correcting coworkers that we don't even talk to or go to lunch with. Correcting classmates that we hardly ever speak to. You can't fully correct anyone that you don't love because it's hard for them to receive it.
That's it.
You have to give them and show them love, and they have to know that you love them for them to receive your correction. You know, a lot of us are, you know, I try to tell them, you know, I try to teach them, I try to tell them about Jesus. Show them you love them. Show them the love of Jesus first. Then you correct them. We must count the cost. We must leave everything and follow Jesus. We have to love people so much that it will break our heart if we had a doubt that they might not make it to heaven.
Yeah, yeah.
It should break your heart knowing that there's somebody you know and you wondering if they will ever make it to heaven. And if that's you, the first thing you have to do is start loving them.
Yeah.
Giving them care, sharing things with them, letting them know how much you love them, letting them know how important they are to you. Then you start sharing the good news of Jesus with them.
That's it.
A lack of compulsion is another reason. People just don't care enough anymore about other people. And why would a person make a decision if they know you don't care enough about them?
Yeah.
I love how Philip took what the Lord told him to do. And in some translations said, Philip ran to the chariot. Which means he got excited to run to this Ethiopian eunuch. Someone from another class, another race, and yet he followed God's instruction to run to the chariot and see what was going on in that chariot and found out that this Ethiopian eunuch was reading the word of God and didn't understand. How many of you have seen somebody reading the Bible and you didn't even ask them, what you reading? You knew they were reading the Bible. It's a book that you read also. Common sense seemed like it would have just made you think, I wonder what they're reading in that Bible. What you study?
Yeah.
And then you see they're reading the Gospel of John. Oh, that's my favorite book. What do you think about that? That's a conversation starter.
Yeah.
They even have a Bible in a car and you see them. I see you got a Bible. What's your favorite book of the Bible? It has so many signs and symbols that come our way that we miss a lot of time. If you see a person carrying a Bible, you should ask them. Or if you see a person that's carrying a book, you should be able to ask them, what book is that? Yeah, that's a good book. I say, I don't know too much about that, but my favorite book is the Bible. You know, and then it's just so many things that we can do to point people to get them to be ready to go to the water to be baptized. So, we have to prepare people to go to the water. And how do we prepare? With our life. It's our life that prepares people. Are we willing to listen to the Lord when he tells us to go to somebody and share with them what we know about the Lord? So, things that we need to share with people is that we have humbled ourselves before the Lord. We desire to be baptized, and we got baptized. We want that for you. We have been broken in our hearts and our spirits, and the Lord has restored us and given us a clean heart and a new heart and renewed our spirit. We have to be willing to take upon them the name of Jesus, share Jesus with them, teach Jesus with them, show them the love of Jesus in our life. We have to let them know the rewards of doing this. The rewards of being baptized into the body of Christ is our sins are forgiven. We are adopted as children of God. We have been initiated and pledged into the pledge process of the church. And our character is being shaped by the sign of our baptism into the love and fellowship of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So, the next step. Have you been baptized? Would you like to be baptized? And can you help someone that you love get baptized? I remember belonging to a church organization, and we would have what's called the annual conference. And at the annual conference, that was the opportunity when the pastors of all the different churches would come together and give a report of the year just passed. And during that report, they would give a report of finances. How much money raised. How many people they helped. How many people they fed. How many weddings. How many funerals. How many all these other organizations. And then you get to the point of how many souls got saved? How many did you baptize? And it would just be as quiet as a church mouse when they get to that part. It was like as they want to rush through that. And the church should be ashamed that we don't put enough emphasis on baptism anymore.
That's it.
We talk about how great the praise team is. We talk about how dynamic, how much of a great orator and a preacher our pastors are. We talk about how beautiful the first ladies and the first husbands are. We talk about the children's ministry. We talk about our athletic ministries. We talk about how beautiful and how big our campus is, how pretty the buildings are, who belong to the church. We got the mayor at our church. We got entertainers at our church. Why are we not talking about how many baptisms we're having? Who just got baptized? Who's getting ready to get baptized? We got to do better.
Yes.
We got to be right in the sight of our Lord. If we say we love him, we should bring people to that which we love.
That's it?
Yes. Yes.
Many of us have a favorite movie. And anybody up under the sun who knows us know what that favorite movie is. Many of us have favorite teams. Anybody that ever listened to us would know what our favorite team is. Many of us have a favorite dish that we love to eat. Whenever anybody want to invite us out to eat, that's what we want to eat, and we'll let you know it. So, when we going to start letting people know about our faith? When we going to let them know about our baptism date? When we accepted Jesus as our Lord and Savior? What he has done for us? When he did it? How he did it? And how he will continue to do that? How we will continue to walk in faith? Have you been to the water? That was an old song that we used to say during baptism, take them to the water to be baptized. None but the righteous shall see Jesus. Take them to the water to be baptized. You could look outside your window right now. It's water out there right now. It's a lot of water. You know, as I get ready to close, what made me really start focusing was the fact that I got a call a while back. And we was having a conversation about somebody who hadn't been baptized. And the person I was talking to said, you know, I really would love for them to be baptized. Would you baptize them? And I said, of course, I would love to. And it just got me to thinking. I said, these are some people who I've known all my life. They are adults and hadn't been baptized. Someone who I know very well. Love them and care about them and is concerned about them. So they asked them, would they like to be baptized? And to everyone's joy, they were so excited. They said, yes, I would love to be baptized. Mm-hmm. And I thought about Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch and started wondering, where was some water? I thought about our church, Champions for Christ. I said, we're online now. We don't have a pool, baptism pool. Mm-hmm. We don't have nothing like that to baptize. So I started calling a few friends. And I asked, I said, you know, when are y'all doing baptism again? We don't know. You know, we got to check the calendar and see. I said, well, we want to get on y'all calendar. Because the next time you done baptism, we want to join you all. Because there are some people that need to be baptized. Mm-hmm. And then I started thinking, I said, well, why do I have to be in a church, in a pool? Why can't I be at any pool of water? Mm-hmm. Why can't I be in somebody's bathtub? Why can't I be at a river, at a lake? That's what they used to use. Mm-hmm. Why do we have to be so sophisticated now that we have to put baptism on a calendar so many days out in advance? We have to get the proper clothing for everybody to wear. We have to plan this elaborate service with elaborate meal behind it, when somebody might not have that much time in their life and they want to go down as soon as possible.
Yeah, yeah.
Why not offer baptism every Sunday when you offer worship experiences? Mm-hmm. Especially if you have a tub. Why not run a little water in to keep it ready? That person might not come back next week. Mm-hmm. So while that person's heart is ready to be baptized this week, why not? Why not if you're at church and you're in your office and you got staff members there with you and somebody come and you know that that person don't belong to a church and you talk to them and they want to be baptized, why not go baptize them then?
Yeah, yeah.
Baptism matters. It matters. Mm-hmm. Serving the Lord matters. We need to get in a hurry. Mm-hmm. We need to be excited, and we need to be as swift as Philip was to run to get people in the right connection with Jesus.
All right, all right.
So let's put out the clarion call. Let's make the challenge today that baptism matters. So when you ask people about their church, ask them, how many did y'all baptize this week? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Don't ask about what songs the praise team or choir song. You only have to ask about the sermon sometimes. Mm-hmm. Ask about who just got saved at y'all church. Who just gave their life to the Lord? How many baptisms did y'all do this year? How many baptisms did y'all do last year? Mm-hmm. How many baptisms are you hoping for next year?
All right.
How many baptisms would you like to have? That's what it's all about. Baptism is a sign. And once you get the sign, then you start developing the character of that sign. Mm-hmm. I didn't know about Virgo until someone told me that because I was born in the month of September between the dates of the Virgo cusp, that I was a Virgo. Mm-hmm. So what did I do? People started telling me about what Virgos are like. Then I had to start reading what Virgos was like. And as I looked at my characteristic trait, I saw some similarities of me and other Virgos. Wouldn't it be nice if we had the same type of thing in the church? Mm-hmm. Your sign is baptism. Mm-hmm. And because of baptism, you're a Christian. And because you're a Christian, you pray.
That's it.
You put all your faith and hope and trust in the Lord. You love everyone just like the Lord loved you.
Yes.
That's your sign. Mm-hmm. Take them to the water. Let's pray.
Yes.